I wanted to talk about some work that should appear soon with Ben Heidenreich, Ajit Surut, and Matteo Lotito. And it is a work that, well, I titled it The Confining a Class of Unequal to Two Superconformative Theories as a working title. But it's really about how to construct n equal to one Lagrangians for a class that I will introduce in a second of n equal to two superconformative theories. Right, so I want to construct some non-conformal equal to one theories that flow to the, in the IR to some superconformative theory that has enhanced supersymmetry. One thing, please interrupt me at any time if there are any questions. I'm happy to be interrupted. So the theories that I will discuss are within the set of class S theories. So I don't think this needs a lot of introduction in this audience, but just to set the stage, I will summarize that briefly in a second. And you construct these theories by wrapping 2.0 theories in six dimensions on Riemann surfaces. And we know many things about these theories. There's a lot of beautiful papers that extract important information about these theories. But the case is that we don't know Lagrangians for most of them. And you still want to know Lagrangians, even if you already know quite a bit, because whenever you have a Lagrangian, you can check these things, that, these rules that you derived. And typically you can obtain more refined information. As an example, in many of these cases, the full superconformal index is not known, but it's known in some limits, like a Schur limit and so on. You have an equal to one Lagrangian, you can construct the index and do other things. All right, so not to mix things up too much, I want to try to be careful with terminology in my talk. So I need to use two different but related notions of duality. And I will try to keep them separate, but if at any point it gets confusing, please ask. I will use Montonin-Olive duality, Montonin-Olive duality, although I will most of the time call it SL2C duality or S duality. And here what happens is that you have some family of CFTs parameterized by a conformal manifold. And as you go to different limits in this conformal manifold, to the cusps, you obtain different weak coupling descriptions. So I will say that these different weak coupling descriptions are related by S duality whenever you have such a conformal manifold. So I will use mostly this SL2C duality as a technical tool in a way to derive what I really want, which is universality. That is, I will construct a UV description of some CFT, that is some theory which is not exactly a CFT, but it will flow to the CFT and there are flow in there. Okay. So I'll try to be careful, but again, I might sleep. I mean, if I do so, please ask. So let's just start with classes, just to, as I said, to set the stage. You start with the six dimensional 2.0 theory. And we believe that all such theories arise from TEP to be on ALE singularities. Here gamma is a discrete subgroup of SU2, or you can have products of these theories, but let's keep it simple. And you have the classification. And in this talk, I will all the time talk about the SUN case. So gamma is simply the cyclic group set N. So if you put this theory in a Riemann surface with punctures, then you're expected to obtain some n equal to two superconformative theories. And we call this class of theories constructing this way class S theories. And one of the many reasons why these theories are interesting is that it's fairly simple to understand duality in this language. And here by duality, I mean S duality. So at least you can construct some S dualities by deforming the complex structure of the Riemann surface. And as it pinches in different ways, you obtain different dual descriptions of the same theory. So the picture that you can draw is that you have some generic Riemann surface, you take a limit, and then the surface decomposes into some little balls, which are some building blocks, with some CFTs, and then you have some tubes connecting them, and in these tubes you have a Yamin's theory with coupling that engages part of the flavor symmetry of the CFTs. Okay, so this construction is very familiar, so I'm being brief, but if there are questions, please ask. So this is a classification by Chakalthana, Bisler, and collaborators of many possible theories that appear in this way. In particular, they classify these little blobs here, the CFTs that appear. And I will focus on a very specific class of CFTs that appear naturally in our construction, but they appear also in the construction. And these are the theories that appear when you take the strongly coupled limit of n equal to 2, the n equal to 2 Lagrangian theory with this matter content. So this is SU2n, and you have a symmetric, sorry, anti-symmetric and asymmetric. So in this theory, the gauge coupling of SU2n is a marginal parameter, so you have a conformal manifold. In one limit of the conformal manifold, you have this Lagrangian description, but you can go to infinite coupling, so to speak. And in this dual description, in a paper by Chakalthana, Bisler, and Tachikawa, they found that what you get is this thing here. I'm using notation which I believe is not completely standard, but just to write it briefly. So you have some CFT called R2 2n minus 1, and this CFT has a global symmetry group which is spin 4n plus 2 times U1, and you gauge part of this global symmetry group. So by this curly arrow, what I mean is that you are gauging this subgroup of the global flavor symmetry group. So you are gauging a spin 2n plus 1 inside a spin 4n plus 2 times 1. Right? So this is the answer that they proposed, generalized improving analysis by other people. You can also do the even rank case, which is a little bit more mysterious technically. But the answer is reasonably similar. So you start with SU2n plus 1, and again with a symmetric and antisymmetric. And when you go to strong coupling, you get a CFT, which it's called the R2 2n theory, and you gauge part of the flavor symmetry group. So in this case, the CFT has global symmetry group USP4n times U1, and you gauge USP2n subgroup. Okay. So I want to focus on these theories, and it will be clear in a second way. I believe our construction is a bit more general, but these are the examples we have fully worked out in this paper. So geometrically, as I mentioned, this also has a very beautiful interpretation. You have the SUN with symmetric and anti-symmetric can be obtained by starting with a torus with one puncture and a twist. This the dashed line here is the twist. And depending on which limit you take, you either get the theory with symmetric and antisymmetric, or you get the R2K superconformal theory with part of the global symmetric edge. Okay, I don't need to go into details, but you still have a picture in mind of how these things work geometrically. Okay, so originally not much was known. You can write the class's description. It looks like this. Basically, you isolate this part here, and if you like engage this thing, it means open up this interval. And then you end up with a sphere with three punctures. One is a minimal puncture, and then you have two full punctures. But the peculiarity is that the full punctures are twisted, that is, they're connected by a monodromy of the SUN back theory, 2.0.
Sorry for the interruption. We don't see any pointer. I don't see any pointer. I don't know if that's okay.
Yeah, okay. Thank you for letting me know. I was under the impression you would. So I will try to say it in words. I've been moving the
pointer. Yeah, I'm not sure.
Okay. Thank you. All right, so I'll try to. Maybe I can do this. So, no, I can't do it. Sorry. All right. I'll try to match. So from here, from this description, we can read things such as the central charges, the dimensions of the Coulomb and Higgs branches, and various indices. So we know some things about these theories. You know the global symmetries, of course, things like that. And they're still interesting theories. So the two minimal cases are the ones I will focus on. Our construction works in general for any k. I want to highlight the lowest rank ones, the rank one cases. So R23 is a theory that's well known, is the Minahan-Nemechansky theory of type E6 of rank one. It's also known as T3. And in this case, there's a symmetry enhancement. So R23, as I stated it, has some spin 4n plus 2 times U1, but this flavor symmetry group in this case enhances to E6. Yeah. And the R22 case is perhaps a little bit less known, but it's also very interesting, is the one of their Eurosweepic theories, has global symmetry USP4 times U1. So in this talk, just to keep it brief, as brief as I can, I will focus on these two examples. Right. So my goal here is to construct an equal to one Lagrangians that flow to these superconformal field theories. And I want to do it constructively. I want to present some string theory background that I do some manipulations to it, and it gives me the dual, so a Lagrangian for this R2K theories. So I will give some non-conformal n equal to one theory that is expected to enhance to n equal to two, and the n equal to two theories that you get are these superconformal field theories. So this is not the first work in this direction, of course. There's other very nice papers. So there are papers by Gader, Rothermatt, and Willett that give a somewhat exotic n equal to one Lagrangian in quotes. They put it in quotes, so I'm not trying to put a scare quote for you. And it's exotic in the sense that you have to gauge a symmetry that's only visible at infinite coupling. So although their construction is very useful and it's a beautiful paper, it's not perhaps a thing I'm after. Then, of course, you have the beautiful series of papers by Marius and Song and collaborators that give many n equal to one Lagrangians for Arguello's Douglas theories or generalizations. I want to emphasize, although I will make some comments about Arguello's Douglas later, that what we're finding is a different class of theories. So what they find doesn't apply to R2K, and the constructions that we have don't immediately give Lagrangians for Arguello's Douglas. We can find some of the Marius's own Lagrangians in some cases, but only in some special cases. So there's not a lot of overlap between this class of theories, but in some cases you can connect the two discussions by RG flow. So it's a nice check of the computations. And a paper that is also very relevant is a paper by Zafrir, where he finds n equal to one Lagrangians for R2 2K plus one. And I don't know how to relate the Lagrangians that he finds and the ones that we find. The approaches are very different. He's basically searching for theories and we are constructing them. But presumably the two things are, they're expected to be in the same universality class. So I wouldn't be very surprised if there are some sequence of cybervarieties that relate to two constructions. There's a difference, perhaps a technical one, I don't know. But in our construction, you can see the full symmetry group, or at least the maximal rank subgroup. And in his, only a subgroup is apparent. Of lower rank. So computing superconformal indices is a bit easier in our construction. But this might be just a matter of value difference. All right, anyway, let's go into the fun part. So how do you find Lagrangians for these theories? And I will do it, I like to think of it as I'm doing the hard way, because there's probably a better, easier, and prettier way. And I'm hoping somebody listening to this might understand how to do this in a better way than we did. But this is what we were able to do so far. So as I mentioned, these are the theories that appear in the strong coupling limit of a simple theory, which is SUN with symmetric and anti-symmetric. And we know how to construct this theory in a string theory. That's fairly easy. So you can put the D3 brains on some singularities, C2 mod Z2 times C, fairly standard orbital singularity. And as opposed to the previous talk, here I like singularities, so all this talk will be about singularities. But it's a nice singularity, we understand what happens. So you cannot just put this singularity, you have to introduce an orientifold to obtain these tenor representations. But this is fairly well understood. Okay, so I have this construction. How do I read what happens to this theory at a strong coupling from a string theory? So first of all, I will start by embedding these n equal to two theories into n equal to one theories. And the advantage of these n equal to one theories is that the singularity will be isolated. So for those of you who are familiar with the geometry, you have this kind of geometry, this kind of Clavier threefold, you have a line of singularities going to infinity. And for reasons which are probably not very deep, but are technically annoying, it's easier to work with isolated singularities than non-isolated ones. So that's why we went to n equal to one theory. So, all right, so you construct these n equal to one theories basically by coupling some set of massive modes to your n equal to two theory that break the symmetry to n equal to two. You bring these modes to be massless, and then in the IR, you end up having some interesting n equal to one superconformal field theory that I will describe in a second. So now you take this n equal to one theory and you extend it to a strong coupling and you write a Lagrangian for that. So imagine many of you are thinking how it can possibly that be simpler. But luckily we solved this in a series of papers with Ben. So we know how to do this for any isolated n equal to one theory. But so basically we do this step of unhixing because we know how to solve n equal to one problem. N equal to two problem, we haven't solved it yet, but I believe there must be an intrinsic solution without going through n equal to one. And then once you have gone to a strong coupling in n equal to one, you undo this coupling of the n equal to one sector and you isolate again the n equal to two part. Right. So what we are proposing is that there is some sort of commutative diagram of this kind, and the details will become clear as I go on. But when you see this triangle on the top left with the arrows and the stars and so on, this means the original n equal to two theory you want to construct. Now you go to the right, I'm going to attach another copy of this triangle. Now I have something like a square, and this thing is n equal to one theory in the string engineering. Now we know from my papers with Ben how to S-dualize this. So you obtain the same geometry, but now a dual description with a Lagrangian that we know how to construct. And then you take away the piece that you attached to obtain another n equal to two theory. But the claim is that this diagram is commutative, basically because this attaching and detaching of the geometry in string theory are Keller moduli, while the S-dualization is tuning the string coupling, and you can do these two things independently, and you're supposed to have supersymmetric theory. So with a bit of luck, there will be no phase transition. So let's assume that, and then we will check it. But if things really commute, then you have a commutative square that in the end will give you the S-dual of n equal to two theory. And additionally, because we work this out in n equal to one, we will know how to construct Lagrangians for this n equal to two theory. So not only are we given a string realization of the R2K theory, which wouldn't be too exciting, but the interesting part is that for the n equal to one theories, we know how to construct Lagrangians for any of them. And of course, once you have a Lagrangian, you can Higgs it without any trouble. So that will give you the Lagrangians for n equal to two. Right, so this is the strategy, and now I want to implement it. But if there are any questions about the strategy, maybe now it's a good time. So let me go on. I want to construct an n equal to one generalization of Montonian olive duality. So I want to see what happens when I have a conformal manifold of n equal to one theories, and I start moving this conformal manifold. Yeah, if I start with a Lagrangian description, what happens when I crank up the coupling to infinity? So say that you have let's start with n equal to four case, which is more familiar. So if you start with a 4D n equal to four free theory with gauge group G and gauge coupling tau. There's a completely equivalent description with another gauge group, which may or may not be the same, already G check, and coupling minus one over tau. So for example, you put theta equal to zero, this is the dual theory has one over G as a coupling. So in many cases, the theory is similar, or perhaps it differs by global structure issues, which are just subtle. So you can have U1, you can have that goes to U1, UN is dual to UN, SUN is dual to SUN mod CN or PSUN, SO2N is again self-dual, but the case that's perhaps more interesting is the SO2N plus one, which is dual to USP2N. And one reason this is interesting is that these are really different algebras, so you can distinguish these two theories perturbatively. So at the same value of the coupling, these are definitely very different theories. It's only when you connect G with one over G that they become the same theory. So these dualities are very non-perturbative. Basically they exchange electrically charged operators with magnetically charged ones. And this makes the duality exciting, but of course hard to check. So it will be useful to think of the conformal manifold in this way. So here what I did, I took the upper half plane and I conformally mapped it to the disk through this transformation on the top left. And then what you should be thinking is that you start, for example, in the top, where there's this sort of pink block, there's a weak coupling description. And then you start moving in this conformal manifold and you want to see what happens when you hit any of the other limits in this conformal manifold. So ideally you would like to have a description for any of the other pink blobs on the boundary of this disk. So that's the problem that we want to solve in n equal to 1. And from there, we'll read the solution for n equal to 2. All right, so of course, in field theory, that's hard, as I mentioned. So in string theory, the problem becomes easier. So one way, at least easier to predict what the answer is. So you can construct four-dimensional field theories from a string theory by essentially constructing a full 10-dimensional theory and constructing some sort of soliton inside that, where the field theory dynamics localize. So in this case, that's fairly straightforward. You can just put D3 brains in type 2 string theory, and then the coupling in the field theory is related in a simple way to the coupling in string theory. So this is the kind of picture. You have some six-dimensional space, which I drew as a cone, but for example, for n equal to 4, this cone will be the cone over S5, so it's really just R6, but it will be useful to think of this as a cone in general. And at the tip of the cone, you put some objects. So in this case, if you put just D3 brains, you end up with UN Jamming's theory, n equal to 4. And if you put orientifolds, then you get the SO and SP versions of n equal to 4. Right, so you can do this picture putting D3s and O3s, and in that case, you end up with SO and SP. Right, so the key idea for understanding duality in string theory, n equal to 4 multinomial duality, is that you don't really need to look at the core of at the tip of the cone here. Sorry for changing page so much. You can understand duality by looking at infinity, at this L5D, which is the base of the cone. But you can look far away from the brain system. And then you have a smooth supergravity theory where it's easier to understand what S-duality does. So you can understand the structure of duality by looking at infinity. And if you understand what happens at infinity, and if you can reconstruct from a configuration at infinity what happens at the singularity, then you can understand duality. So let's do it in equal to 4. This is a bit abstract, but this can be made very concrete. So this is again the picture, another commutative diagram, so to speak. So you have the 4D field theory that you engineer with D3s and O3s in some point in some transverse space, which may or may not be singular. For n equal to 4, it's not. And then what you do is you look at what happens with supergravity as you take g to large values. So in a string theory, that will be taking gs to large values, but then you can do an SL2C transformation of a string theory and get a type 2B theory with the small values of g, maybe with different configuration fields. Now you know what happens to the fields at infinity. And the question is, if you have some set of fields at infinity, what is the field theory dynamics that they induce at the singular point with the D brains and so on? Right, so we need to know basically how D brains transform, how O planes transform, and if we know those rules, then we can reconstruct the effect of the duality in the field theory from geometry at infinity. Right, so let's do that for n equal to 4. This is from the paper of Witten. So the charges of an O3 plane are classified by the cohomology at infinity. So here infinity is the 5 sphere that surrounds the origin, but because I'm putting an orientifold plane, this is a quotient, a set two quotient of the sphere, so this is RP5. And then you want to classify, well, you want to look at what happens to the supergravity fields. So you have to distinguish whether the orientifold action gives an intrinsic minus sign to the supergravity fields. So things like F5, they don't get an extra sign because of minus 1 FL omega. So their values at infinity are classified by ordinary cohomology, in particular the degree 5 cohomology of RP5, and that simply is set integers. So basically, this is the familiar statement that you can measure how many D3 brains you have by counting the integral of F5 at infinity, modulo small shifts. And for fields odd under the orientifold action, H3 and F3, so these are fields that get an intrinsic minus sign under minus 1 FL omega, and additionally they get the geometric action, the set 2, on S5. Then these are not classified by ordinary cohomology, but they're classified by something known as cohomology with local coefficients. So I will not discuss it. You have a brief explanation here, but I will just quote the values. So importantly, these are degree 3 fluxes. So they live in H3. And if you look at the degree part of these cohomology with local coefficients, you get that this is set 2. So interestingly, H3 can take discrete values. It can be 0 or 1 half, say. And F3 can also take discrete values, 0 or 1 half. So we have in total 4 different possibilities for H3 and F3. So we can draw them like this. This is a little diagram where I have F on the horizontal axis and H in the vertical axis. And well, if you go to Witten's paper, you will find how he assigns, he interprets these different flags in terms of orient defaults. I'm just going to give you the answer. So if you have the trivial flags, both H and F are 0, no flags at infinity, then that's the O3 minus case. And that can be identified with the SO2N theory, meaning that you put N D3 grains on top of that, you get the SO2N N equal to 4 Yamiche theory at lower energies. If you put non-trivial fluxes, then life becomes more interesting. So if you put 0 H but non-zero F, so you put a Ramon-Ramon unit of flux, then you get something that he called the O3 minus tilde. And at low energies, this is the SO2N plus 1 theory. You can think of this as a D3 brain stuck on the O3 plane, a half D3 stuck on the O3 plane. Okay, so this is one thing that you can do. Alternatively, you can put F to 0 and you turn on H. In this case, you change the type of the orient default plane. You go from having no 3 minus to having no 3 plus. So if you put D3 brains on top, you get the USP2N theory. And you can do both. You can turn on F and you can turn on H, and you again get the SP theory, USP2N. So he called this the O3 plus tilde. And there's no really much difference between the O3 plus and the O3 plus tilde. And so let me obviate the difference for the rest of the talk and treat them as the same, as the same theory, essentially. The interesting bit is that now we can understand simply this action of Montonin-Olive duality in this theory. So we have fluxes at infinity, H and F. And we know that under SL2C of type 2B, these things transform as a doublet. So in particular, you have the theory at the top left, the O3 plus theory, and their S duality will become the theory in the bottom right, the O3 minus tilde. Right? S duality exchanges F and H. So this is the string theory interpretation of the Montonin-Olive duality between SO2N plus 1 and USP2N. And you can understand this from infinity. Right? You don't have to understand what happened to the brain to understand duality. What we need then is a map between fluxes to theories, but that's precisely what I will solve. Any questions?
So you can have self-duality for USP2N, right? So can you have that kind of class of theory for N equal 2? I mean, N equal 4, probably they are related by T, but N equal 2 could have a different class, which is self-dual with SPN gauge group.
Yeah, so n equal to 4, then the interpretation of the self-duality of the O3 plus tilde is that the gauge coupling of the O3 plus tilde is not exactly the string theory coupling, there's a little shift. And when I say S-duality here, I mean S-duality of the type 2B coupling. So you can check that the induced action on the field theory is a composition, as you say, of T and S, and some others, T, S, T, something. So that's indeed the self-duality of the field theory. And in lower supersymmetry, yes, there are examples of theories with this self-dual behavior too, exactly the same thing. So in a paper with Ben, we studied the C3 mod Z3 example, which is n equal to 1. And the duality diagram, sort of the version, the n equal to 1 version of this diagram for that theory is identical. You can draw the same picture. And you have some SP version of self-duality also in that case. So there's not an equal to 4 specific.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, I'm happy to give more details later after the talk if you like. But yeah, this is generic. This comes up to what points are generic. All right, so let me discuss what happens with n equal to 1. So, well, in principle, n equal to 2, So this Montalun olive is originally was proposed, well, I guess the original proposal was refined to n equal to 4, which was the case where it was most obviously plausible. But type 2b S duality, which is the thing I'm using to argue for S duality, is believed to hold in general. So you can do the same thing. You can engineer n equal to 1 theories in 2b. You look at what happens at infinity for this n equal to 1 configurations. You read the effect of S duality on the charges. And then once you know what happens at infinity, you try to reconstruct what happens at the singular point, which is the effective four-dimensional description. So with Ben, we have completed this program for a large class of n equal to 1 superconformal field theories. And we did it for a class of theories. So it's a large class, but it's not, of course, all n equal to 1 theories. So these are the theories that arise from B3 brains probing orientifolds of singularities. So we took some simplifying assumptions. All of these are technical, and I believe they can be lifted, but I haven't done it. So we assume that geometry is toric before and after orientifolding. And this is mostly so we can use this nice technology of dimer models or brain tilings. We assume that the singularity is isolated, simply because I want to make a statement about supergravity at infinity. And if there's a line of singularities going to infinity, I have to worry about defining singular cohomology, cohomology for singular spaces, which requires a bit of care. So to avoid that complication, we assume that the singularity was isolated. And perhaps more interestingly, we also assume that the orientifold fixed point is isolated. So one thing that can happen is that you could have an orientifold plane going to infinity. And that's going to be an interesting thing. We are starting to think about that, but for the moment, we assume that there's only localized orientifold loss. Okay, and a reminder again, here I'm talking about having an equal to one conformal manifold, and I'm moving in this conformal manifold, and I want to understand what happens as I hit different limits in the coupling constant. Okay, so there are many toric spaces, and there's a very rich class of theories you can construct out of toric spaces. So here's a list, flat space itself is a toric space. You have projective spaces, which are compact. So there's a sort of no-go that you cannot have a toric compact Calabi-Yau space. You have to choose two out of the three. Here I'm mostly talking about non-compact toric Calabi-Yau spaces. A famous example of a non-compact toric Calabi-Yau space is the conifold, but you can also do abelian orbifolds of flat space. You can do the Delpechos, properly speaking, the Calabi-Yau cones of the Delpechos, LPQR, and so on. Basically, as I'll explain in a second, whenever you have a convex polytope in set two, that gives rise to a geometry. And so you have an infinite class of examples. Not only infinite, but very rich. So there are many qualitatively different classes of examples. All right, so just to keep some examples in mind, please keep in mind the triangles. Triangles here mean either C3, or if it is a triangle with points along the edges, those are orbifolds of C3. Right. So here are two examples. You have a triangle with no lattice points along the edges. That's a sort of the toric description of a flat space. You have a triangle with points along the edges. That's a toric description of an orbifold of flat space. So the kind of thing that engineers n equal to 2. If you have something which is not a triangle, then it's n equal to 1. And here are two or three important examples. So the conifold is just a square with no points along the edges. And then you get the DP0, which is a triangle. So this is a different orbifold of flat space. And sorry, the statement I made before, maybe it was too simple. Anything that's a triangle is an orbifold of flat space. If you have points along the edges, you get n equal to 2. If you have points which are interior, you get n equal to 1. If you have DP1, this is not a triangle, and this is a theory which is sort of intrinsically n equal to 1. Okay, so let's do the general case. We want to understand the topology at infinity. So for a toric O3 or 7 orientifold of a toric Calabi-Yau cone, and this toric, the toric diagram for the cone will have k sides. And we assume, as before, that the geometric singularity is isolated at the origin, and the orientifold leaves only the origin fixed. then you can compute the topology at infinity. And in particular, you can compute these values of H3 and F3. And there's a very simple formula that for H3, for example, you get set to or k minus one direct copies of set two. Okay, so k minus two direct copies of set two. So the case I was doing before, n equal to four is D3 is in flat space. Flat space is a triangle, like the top row here has three sides, so k equal to three. And 3 minus 2 is 1. So this is the result I quoted before, that H3 of S5 mod set 2 with local coefficients is a set 2. Right? So this reproduces what we claimed before. But now we can do it in general for any K-sided toric geometry. So for example, you take the complex cone over DP1, you get a set 2 plus set 2. So you get 4 choices for H3 and 4 choices for F3. So in total, you get 16 types of orientiform planes. Right, and now you can classify these things because these are just H3 and F3. You know how they transform under SL2C. So you can see the representations of SL2C. You got a singlet, 3 triplets, and 1 sextet of SL2C. And because this shift of the Ramon-Ramon flux in the field theory doesn't do much, it just shifts the theta angle. In terms of weakly coupled limits, this reduces to 10 different weakly coupled limits. So 10 different theories that you should be able to identify by putting different types of orientifolds and D-brains on the DP1 singularity. Right? So this is the prediction from the geometry. There should be 10 different low energy descriptions of brains at orientifolds of DP1. And furthermore, these different descriptions should be related by SL2C in this complicated pattern. So I apologize for the, I tend to use colors for this figure, that's my change. So you cannot see colors. What I have here is the triplets and the sextet and the singlet. So for example, the theories at 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 1, and 0, 0, 0, 1, those 3 points on the diagram, those are the triplet of SL2C. So these arrows basically tell you how to relate theories and their the T transformation and the S transformation of SL2C. So these are all the possible orientifold configurations that you can put here. And our task is to reconstruct what happens at the singularity, knowing this behavior of the fluxes at infinity. Okay, so the first thing you should do is go to literature and see what people found for these geometries. Basically, there are these two classes of theories that you can construct, and we call it type 2A and type 2B. And using the brain tiling description, but let me sort of ignore that. This is a way of systematically constructing these theories. And you end up with two sort of quiver descriptions, the things you see at the bottom, which are fairly similar, but slightly different. So you see that you have SU times SU, but on one side you have one symmetric, on the left, you have one symmetric and 3 antisymmetrics, while on the right you have 1 antisymmetric and 3 symmetrics. Right. And this is basically because you have chosen the signs of the orientifold fixed point in the break tiling slightly different. So that's what was known. Let me summarize a little bit how to read this brain tiling, because I will draw some figures like this. So first of all, the stars. So first of all, you should think of this square as a torus. So the top and bottom lines are identified, and the left and right lines are identified. So this is a torus. And the four stars are the 4 fixed points of the orientifold on the torus. So the orientifold maps the torus to itself, leaving 4 fixed points. So those are the orientifold fixed loci on the torus. And they can be assigned signs. There are some consistency rules, but at the level of this talk, you can think that these signs are independent, although they're not, but you basically assign signs to them. Then you have the lines that I'm drawing. The lines are NS5 brains that end on this torus. And then you have, this induces some sort of tessellation of the torus. And you should think of the white areas as gauge factors and the color areas as interactions. Yeah, so this is the map. And then when there were 2 white areas are touching, for example, in the center, you see that the white area on the top left and the white area on the bottom right are touching at the point on top of the orientifold in the middle. And there you get some sort of chiral field of n equal to one field. So in this way, by these rules, you can extract the quiver and superpotential for these theories from these pictures. And the details are not super important, so this was too fast. That's okay. The only thing I want to emphasize is that there are systematic rules for extracting the physics from these drawings. All right, so now you take these theories, you start computing, you start imposing anomaly matching, superconforming index matching, and so on, and you see that you can associate theories to half of the points in the duality area. You can associate theories to half of the fluxes at infinity that you can introduce. But you have some theories that you don't know what to do with. Okay, so the assumption in these previous classifications is that you get a brain tiling with a perturbative description. So implicitly, in what people were doing before, you impose that you never have more than two NS5s intersecting at the point. Why is that? If you have two NS5s intersecting at the point, this gives rise, in this language, to a bifundamental, a chiral field, which you can describe a weak coupling. But if you have four or more, this is always even because of the identifold, and you have four or more, then you get some sort of a strongly coupled superconformal field theory where these four brains intersect. But you can still draw the picture. So I drew it here in the bottom right. This is a possible set of NS5 brains, which is compatible with the DP1 geometry. The problem is that one of the sectors is a strongly coupled conformal field theory. So it looks like this, four brains intersecting at the point. So here's what one of the things we did in the paper with Ben is to give a Lagrangian description of this superconformal field theory. We found an n equal to one theory that flows, n equal to one Lagrangian, that flows to this superconformal field theory. And has a very beautiful brain interpretation. So it's a generalization of the confinement, anti-symmetric deconfinement, which was introduced in this nice paper by Bercot and Puglio. So let's try to understand anti-symmetric deconfinement in this brain language. And this generalizes the story of, that's why I call it the confinement, the confinement equal to two theories. So let's say that you start with USP n minus four with n chiral superfields. This theory will confine, or we believe it confines, and at low energies is described by a meson with a superpotential. Okay, and so that's interrogator and Puglio. You can complicate the theory by introducing some extra fields, extra interactions, and so on. And what happens if you follow the rules of cyberduality is that you end up with an anti-symmetric at the end, a very simple theory, just a free anti-symmetric. So you can think of the anti-symmetric theory and the anti-symmetric chiral multiplet as the end result of having these complicated gauge sectors and letting it flow to the air. Okay, this seems like an enormous complication, but here comes the nice thing. If you start, let's think how you engineer an anti-symmetric in string theory in this kind of context. So you can construct two NS5 brains intersecting on top of an orientifold, if the orientifold is of minus 10. Right, so what does the confinement do in the brain picture? So what you're doing is you're taking these two brains intersecting over the orientifold plane, and you're sort of pulling them apart by hand and opening up some gap in the middle where no NS5 lives. Right, so you can do this. You can construct this family of topologies, if you like, that in the singular limit becomes the theory that you are after, the anti-symmetric. And if you read using the brain, so the rules of brain engineering, the theory on the right, which fields it has, which couplings it has, you precisely reproduce the theory that Puglio and Bercot constructed. This complicated structure that you see at the bottom is precisely the field theory description of this brain system on the right. So the confinement is this operation, sort of pulling brains apart to give an energy. And this is also a problem because now you have four brains intersecting. You can take two of them. Here I took the two on the right, the red and green, and you pull them apart together so in this the confining way. And now you get only two brains intersecting at an endpoint. And that can be described perturbatively. You could do the same thing for the two brains intersecting at the origin if you like. That's not necessary. The figure on the right is already perturbative. So this gives an equal to one Lagrangian. Okay, so if you do this and you know from the brain description you read what the Lagrangians are, you get these complicated Lagrangians. but I emphasize this completely. Lagrangians are constructed systematically. You draw this picture and then you scratch your head for 50 minutes and draw this thing. In the paper with Ben, we give the rules, so there are not that many cases, and you can solve this in the end. So like complicated looking by systematic. So there are two options here. Basically, they're sort of analog to putting the plus sign for the identifier and the minus sign for the identifier. We call them the QUSP theory and the QSO theory. And this is because of the global symmetries. In one case, they're SP, in another case, they're SO. So these are n equal to one theories that flow to interacting fixed points, which are the interacting fixed points arising from brains intersecting identifier. So the left part of this figure. By this, the confining procedure, you can give the Lagrangian description. Okay, now everything is easy. So you draw the brains in all the possible ways, topologically possible ways. The things that have four brains or more intersecting, you deconfine, so you can construct Lagrangians for them. And in this way, you construct a bunch of new theories for VP1. They look like this, splash them, it's matter. The important thing is that if you look now at how they fit in this diagram, of possible theories in DP1, you obtain all the missing dots. So the theories that appear at the strong coupling for some of the Lagrangian theories that people already knew are theories that include a superconformal sector with weakly gauged global symmetries.
In your case?
Yep.
You have 5 minutes.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, should be. All right, and then you can do the usual checks. So you can check the superconformal indices, you can start doing Higgsings and so on. And everything works. So this is the final picture. You have, for DP1, you have four theories. Two of them, the ones on the top, those are Lagrangian, the standard Lagrangian things, the things that people found. But then in the conformal manifold, there are cusps, there are limits, where you obtain these superconformal field theories, which I drew with the OSP rhombi here, that couple to the rest of the system through weak gauging. So this is similar to the inequality. Okay, and we have Lagrangians for these superconformal sectors. That's important. Right, and I should mention that I presented this in the sort of way we found it, which is by consistency of DP1, but then in a later paper with Ben, we found systematic rules, and we have a constructive way of doing all these things. So now it's basically cranking the handle and constructing dualities. And that's useful because these kind of superconformal field theories, they look a little bit complicated, but they're very generic. So if you try to put brains on orientifolds on toric singularities, and the toric singularity has more than four sides, all the faces of the n equal to one theories are non-classical. They include these CFTs. So we started, Ben and I, with Tim Russell, started studying these theories in the case of C3 mod Z3, which luckily this does not happen, and this was very encouraging. If we had decided to study a general case from the beginning, we have probably given up. But we didn't. So in DP2, for example, you see this is the structure. You always get these strongly coupled sectors. So this is the full solution for DP2. And again, you can do it for interaction. Okay, let's go back to n equal to 2. Now we know how to solve the n equal to 1 problem, which in principle should be harder. So n equal to 2 is mostly an exercise. So we're interested in understanding the strongly coupled limit of this SUN with symmetric and antisymmetric. You can engineer this by putting D3s on an orientifold C2 mod Z2 times C. So remember, this is a triangle with points along the edge. Now we complete this triangle to this square on the right, basically putting another copy. This is known as the complex cone over F0. And now we have the committing square, but now hopefully you see the strategy a little bit better. So we attach the copy on the right, we S-dualize the n equal to one theory according to the rules I just described, and then you resolve it again. So you do a Keller deformation string theory, a string coupling deformation, a Keller deformation. All right, so if you do this for some choice of n here, you end up with the E6 Minahan-Chensky theory. And you follow the rules I just mentioned, these Lagrangians, Higgs, and so on. And this is the Lagrangian you find for E6. Right. It looks complicated, it is complicated, but I emphasize it can be constructed systematically. There's no ambiguity in this procedure. This is what comes out of the brain construction. And you can check the checks. So A and C work as they should. The superconformal index agrees with the one that was obtained in this nice paper by Gader, Rastelius, and Martin-Jahn. We studied the Higgs and Coulomb branches, they have as they should. And you can do mass deformations and they do what they should. Another example is the R22 theory. Here, as far as I know, there was no Lagrangian before. The thing that we find is a bit easier in this case. In general, surprisingly, the R2 even theories are actually easier to understand from this point of view, which apparently will be a little bit harder in the classes description. But here we can do it. So this is what you get. And again, you can check the things that are known against what you obtain from this theory. So for example, some limits of the superconformal index were computed. We have an equal to one description, a nice equal to one description for the theories. So you can compute the full superconformal index, you can take the limit, and you say it agrees. Another nice thing is that, it was emphasized in this paper by Tachikawa, Wang, and Safrir, that there's a global anomaly for the flavor symmetry in this case, and you can clearly see it here. You have USP4, one fundamental of USP4 with multiplicity 3, so global with an anomaly, which is manifested. Okay, in the interest of time, maybe let me be quick here. So you have Mariyoshi Song. There was a proposal by Beam and Pelayers that you start with R22 and you Higgs it, you end up with A1D4. So we took our Lagrangians, we Higgs them, and we got the Lagrangians, the Mariyoshi, no, the Agarwal Mariyoshi and Song Lagrangians for A1D4. So this supports this construction by Beam and Pelayers. All right, let me finish. So our philosophy for finding equal to one Lagrangians or equal to two theories. We put them in a bigger toric singularity. We attach other singularities, so the resulting singularity is isolated. And this breaks equal to 2 to n equal to 1, so there's a big price to pay, but we know how to solve the n equal to 1 problem. So we do that, and then we Higgs the resulting n equal to 1 theory. We have a Lagrangian, so we obtain n equal to 1 Lagrangians for n equal to 2. Okay, let me finish with some open questions. So we have done this thing I have discussed is essentially the content of our paper, the coming paper. We only do the simplest possible example, C2 mod C2 times C. I believe that more complicated examples will be also interesting. And another thing that's still preliminary in a way in our paper is that we went through all these n equal to one construction simply because we knew the answer n equal to one. But I don't think there's any particular good reason why that's necessary. There should be an intrinsically n equal to two, if you like, intrinsically classes version of this argument that it would be very interesting to understand. So thank you.
Thank you very much for a very nice talk. It's time for questions. You can raise your hands or you can unmute yourself directly. Yes, Kazuyan, please go ahead.
So my question is about this quotient fraction of H3 and F3. So can you always treat them as just an ordinary cohomology? Because the Ramon flux is more generally treated by.
Yeah, good question. Yeah, I don't know. This is certainly an assumption that we are making that seems to work in all cases I have checked. Mm-hmm. And I don't know how to do better because I don't know how. I would like to have some generalized cohomology that behaves nicely under SL2C, and I think this has been constructed.
Mm-hmm. But your research are consistent with just ordinary cohomology?
Yeah, so far, yes. In all cases that we have checked explicitly, this gives the answers that you. That then you can go and check superconformal indices and so on. And everything matches.
So, I see. Thank you.
If we are missing something, it has to be settled. Okay.
Thank you. Any other question? Yes, Cyril.
Hi, Nyaki. Thanks for the nice talk. Can you comment more on what I'm not sure I understand how to go from class S to the Brainard singular, the D3 Brainard singularity setup? Is it
it's not a direct map, so there's two constructions of this theory here on the top, SUN with symmetric and anti-symmetric. You can construct it with Brainard singularities and by putting an O3 plane in this C2 method 2 times C and putting D3s, or you can do the classes description I mentioned before with the torus of one puncture and taking a limit. You can of course connect this through a duality chain, I believe. but the rest of the discussion, I wouldn't know how to do it. So in my discussion, I have attached another copy of this. I went to the geometry on the bottom right here, the complex conover of zero, and started deforming that. I really don't know how to do that in classes. It's an equal to one, so I'm probably doing something a bit complicated in equal to one.
Thank you.
The basic theory, it's the SUN with symmetric and antisymmetric can be constructed in both ways, and I think the limit is so the construction is probably not very difficult.
Thanks.
So the mapping. Which was
mapping. Right.
Thank you. I don't see further questions. Anyone else? It's already six, so we can stop the recording now. And well, let's thank Iñaki again formally.
Okay.